And he's glad that you have a reason to give him praise and give him a shout. Amen. We're so glad. I'm glad I can feel the presence of the Lord. And if I can shout and clap and praise and scream and holler and act like a fool for my football team, I can do it for my Savior. Amen. Amen. Well, if you got your Bibles, turn with me to the book of 1 Samuel chapter 17. And Pastor did a beautiful job this morning challenging us as a body to continue to reach that place where we are continually perfecting our salvation, walking in a place not only through grace, but realizing that it's through the work of God on our life that will continue to his life, his perfection will be manifested as we walk out through his word, his will for our life. In 1 Samuel chapter 17, actually I'm going to read one verse in chapter 16. I'm going to read three or four verses for you, and then for sake of time, I'm just going to stop it there. Tonight we'll be speaking on a simple subject entitled Keys to Being a Giant Killer. How many knows keys unlock things? They also lock things. There are some things we need to bind up. We need to know how to completely demolish and get rid of and get out of our lives. And I believe my prayer is that you leave here with an understanding tonight. Whatever giant it is that you face, you won't have to face anymore. We're going to kill some giants. Amen? 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 13. 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 13. While you're trying to find that, I'll tell you a joke. What do you get when you throw a horse in the ocean? Thank you. A seahorse. Amen. You get that on the way home. All right. Haley told me that today at lunch. I said, well, that's a good joke. Some of you still ain't got it. It's a sea. It's a horse. There you go. All right. 1 Samuel chapter 16. Lord help me. It's a tough crowd tonight. Then Samuel took the horn of oil. And he anointed him being David, in the midst of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. So Samuel arose and went to Ramah. How many remember the day that the Spirit of the Lord came upon you? How many remember when you was anointed, when you gave your heart to the Lord? Amen. What a day. Amen. 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 13. And then we're going to skip to chapter 17, verse 17. Chapter 17, verse 17. And the word of God reads, then Jesse said to his son David, take now for your brothers an orpha of this dried grain and these 10 loaves and run to your brothers at the camp and carry these 10 cheeses to the captain of their 1,000 and see how your brothers fare and bring back news of them. And then skip to verse 20. So David rose early in the morning, left the sheep with a keeper, and took the things and went as Jesse had commanded him. And he came to the camp as the army was going out to fight and shouting for the battle. Tonight our subject, Keys to Being a Giant Killer. Father, we love you. Thank you for your grace and mercy. Thank you for another opportunity to minister your gospel. I count it a privilege and an honor. Hide me behind the cross, God. Cleanse me, purify me. Let my heart be clean. Let my hands be pure. We just declare, Lord, that every word that would come out of this, in this atmosphere, would bring you glory and bring you honor. And we thank you for in advance for lives to be changed and transformed. In Jesus' name, somebody say amen. You can be seated. God bless you. When you find your seat, it's our custom to give God praise for the word of God. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, the key word in this title, if you will, in this message would simply be giant. But before we get to the giants, Let me explain giant to you. First of all, in this story, we all know we're dealing with a man by the name of Goliath. He's a natural giant. He's 9 feet tall. This guy's huge. He's big. He's intimidating. And most of us understand in this scripture that what was happening, there was a battle taking place between the Philistines and the Israelites, or between the Dallas Cowboys and the San Francisco 49ers. Come on, somebody. And the enemy was taunting God's children. The giant was the vocal voice of the total army of the Philistines. You must understand that you're not fighting one enemy. You're fighting a whole host of demonic influences that want to take you out. And if you're a young Christian, or you're a Christian that you've been in this thing for 25 years, you need to understand that there's only one way for deliverance. There's certain keys in your life that you're going to have to portray to be an overcomer. The Bible calls us more than conquerors. Amen? But if we are going to be more than conquerors, if we're going to be overcomers, we must apply some things in our life. Not just on Sunday. Hear me. Not just on Sunday morning. Not just on Sunday night. Not just on Wednesday, because how many knows you don't just fight giants on Sunday night, and Wednesday. But we fight giants 7 days a week, amen? If you don't have any giants, come see me. I'll lend you some. You may fight a giant of financial struggle. You may fight a giant of health problems. You may fight a giant of temptation and falling to all types of lust of the flesh. You may have a giant of a struggle in your marriage, and your husband, you and as a husband and a wife can't get along. And there's bitterness, there's anger, there's words, there's resentment. You may have fought a giant of being cheated on or stolen from or lied to. But at one time or another, you face giants. Here's the good news. The bad news is you're going to face giants. The good news is there is a key to overcome those giants. And I believe the best person to look at in Scripture, one of my favorite men to look at in Scripture of how to defeat giants, is David. Somebody say David. David was a mighty young man. The Scriptures start teaching and start showing us in the book of 1 Samuel chapter 16. David shows up, and his job at the time is to take care of his father, Jesse's sheep. He was being trained to take care of the family's business, if you will. And though it didn't seem important, listen, sometimes the smallest things are the greatest things with the most responsibility. It may be, you may be out in the field and you may feel like nobody cares about what you're doing, but I promise you, if you stop doing what you're doing, everybody's going to notice. If David would have just stopped watching the sheep, and sheep would have started showing up over here, and Brother John's pastor, and Brother JoJo's pastor, and Sister Susie's pastor, if things would have started missing, and money would have started coming up short when it came time to start shearing the sheep, and they didn't have as much cotton wool. There you go. Thank you. Believe me, somebody would have started asking some questions. What's David doing? So, no matter what your position is, no matter where you're at in life, no matter you just got saved today or you've been saved 25 years, how many understands that you are important to the kingdom? Your position, your responsibilities, that what God has entrusted you with, it may be a baby. It may be a teenager. It may be teaching a Sunday school. It may be singing on a stage. It may be ministering the gospel through teaching or preaching. But no matter what it is, you may be vacuuming the floors. You may be cleaning the toilets. But I got news for you. You're just as anointed cleaning the toilets as you are preaching the gospel, singing a song, being in the light, if you will. You don't have to be in the spotlight to be used by God. That's what I'm trying to tell you today. And no matter what you encounter, whether you're the toilet cleaner or you're the pastor of a church, you're going to come against some giants in your life. The key is, in order for you to push through and to not give up and not throw in the towel, is you got to recognize there's a greater purpose. And when you make it through this struggle, when you make it through this giant, there's going to be victory on the other side. Too many people give up too soon, throw in the towel too soon, get a divorce too soon, give up on church too soon before they ever see what God is trying to get them to. I found this, is that if I was ever going to get anything worth having, I was going to have to pay a good price for it. And how many's ever heard the saying, you pay for what you get? If you pay for something that's cheap, it's probably going to be something that's going to last you a little bit of short time. But if you pay the real price and it's you pay its true worth, I got news for you. If you take care of it, the value is going to be based on how you take care of what you paid for. See, when it means something to you, you'll take care of it. You'll protect it. If your relationship with Jesus means something, you won't let some bozo come in and mess up your relationship with the one who died on the cross for you in order to get some little feeling for a moment or two on a one-night stand. If you really know the value that he plays in your life, you won't allow someone who didn't look at you or smile at you or shake your hand when you came in the church, you won't allow that offense to keep you from coming back through the doors and allow you to go to the bars and go to this and go to that or be even a church hopper. Because listen, church hoppers got more problems than people who don't go to church. And this is why. Because they're playing games. They're not committed. They're not faithful. They're not putting themselves in a place to be held accountable. Don't be a church hopper. Be someone that gets stuck, someone who gets connected, someone who has responsibility, someone who's not hiding in the crowd. Yeah. If you really want to have breakthrough in your life, you must realize and recognize God has purpose even for the giants. In David's life, he had purpose. Here's David. He's been watching the sheep. And in verse 16, we find the first anointing that David is given at a young age. Between the age of 13 to 17 years old, many say, he has been anointed. You see the scripture where it says, and Samuel took the horn, verse 13 of chapter 16, and Samuel took the horn of the oil and anointed him in the midst of his brothers. Right after he's anointed, if you look at verse 17 of chapter 17, you will see the first instruction that David is given. It's the next day or 2 days or 3 days or 4 days. I don't know how many days later, but he's been anointed to be king over Israel. Hear me. He's been anointed to be the president, if you will. And the next instruction he's given by his father is, son, I want you to go take some bread and some cheese and be a pizza delivery boy to your brothers out on the battlefield. And David didn't question it. He didn't argue. He didn't say, well, I've been anointed. I'm going to be the king. No, he recognized he had to learn he must submit to authority. First key. If you're taking notes, if you ain't, take them. First key to being a giant killer is we must know how to submit to authority. The level of anointing on your life is determined by the level of submission to the Father's instructions. Now, you may not have a physical outlook. You may not be able to look in the eyes of the God of the Spirit. But God uses men to get kingdom things done. Somebody say amen. He uses men. All since Genesis all the way to Revelation, God chose to use men to get the job done according to the kingdom. So authority is going to fall under some type of man and or woman. And if you're going to be a giant killer, one who can be an overcomer, who's not swallowed up when trouble comes knocking on your door, the first key to being that giant killer is you must learn how to submit to authority. When you submit to authority, you're saying my priority is to serve. Not to control. When your priority is to serve, I can take you scripture after scripture after scripture, New Testament and Old Testament, and show you where even Jesus himself explained that if you're not a servant, you can't be a leader. So if you have a problem coming under submission, if you have a problem coming to a place where you submit to authority, whether it be a pastor, whether it be a boss, whether it be a teacher, whether it be, you know, for children, they have problems. Listen to some adults. If we train up our children, this is what I've learned. It's our responsibility as moms and dads to teach our children while they're children how to submit to authority. If your child is getting use and ends in conduct at school, it's probably because they don't know how to submit to authority. And when I had that problem, and believe me, I did back in the day, my daddy knew how to get the U and the N off of my report card. You know what it was called? It was called B-E-L-T. Belt on the hide. Come on. Y'all act like you don't even know what I'm talking about. Belt on the hide. And it taught me that if I wasn't going to submit, I was going to pay the price. Haley, love you to death, baby. She's my baby girl. But Haley's just like her daddy. She's been stubborn. She's been unsubmissive many times. And we've had to have godly meetings. Say amen, Haley. We've had to have godly meetings. And still do every now and then. And matter of fact, I think we had one today. But that's a process. Somebody say process. And if it's important to you, you would do it. But David, the reason he was a giant killer was because he understood how to submit to authority. Somebody say submit. We leaders must stay submitted to those in authority, not to feel less than, but in order for God to promote us in due season. You want a promotion? If you're a leader, you want to get to the next level. You want to get a raise. You want to be elevated. Listen, learn how to submit to authority. I got news for you. Rather than boasting out your chest and saying, well, I do this, this, and this, and this, and this, and I got this, that, and this, and that, and the other, you're going to get a lot further in life if you just humbly come before the throne of God and say, Lord, if you can use me, use me. No matter what it takes, I'll clean toilets, I'll brush hair, whatever it takes, whatever you want me to do, I just want to serve. God will, what's the scripture says, that he will exalt the humble. He resists the proud. Somebody ought to say amen. Amen. Ladies, I'm trying to help you get your husbands to submit. Amen. All right. Here's a thought for you on that same key. If you're going to kill giants, you must understand authority. Authority does not mean to be ran over. Submitting to godly authority means to surrender one's will so the Father's will can be fulfilled. Is that better to take? Is that better to swallow? Because when we say we must learn to submit to authority, a lot of us don't like to swallow that. But when we understand that it's really not about submitting to a man, it's about submitting to the Father's will so that we can be promoted in days, weeks, months, years to come. Amen? Number two, to be a giant killer, you must be disciplined. Verse 20 of chapter 17, the Bible says, after his father Jesse gave David instructions, verse 20, the first things out of his mouth was simply, so David rose early in the morning. If you're going to be a giant killer, you must be disciplined. David got up early. He had a strategic plan of action. He was organized and focused. If you're going to kill giants, you must not be lazy. I ain't going to get no amens from you teenagers. I know, because you like to sleep in. So do I. But if we're going to get the job done for the kingdom, moms, dads, boys and girls, we must not be lazy. We've got to get up early. We've got to get up early, sometimes go to bed late, but we must fulfill the kingdom principles in our life and pay the price, whatever it takes. If it means we got to pray longer, we got to study harder, we got to witness more. Come on. If we're going to be effective, the one key we got to have is we must be disciplined. I'm constantly trying to discipline myself to not eat a chocolate chip cookie because it's a weakness. So I say, honey, quit buying them chocolate chip cookies. And if she ever sends me to get groceries, you better know I ain't going to tell her I went down the cookie aisle. Discipline. If we stay disciplined spiritually, we must have a discipline about us. If everything goes and we have no boundaries, like Pastor taught on us this morning, if we don't have no boundaries and we don't have no schedules, there is something called order, correct? If you want order in your life, if you want to be able to overcome the enemy, you must strategically outthink the enemy. Don't sleep till noon. Brush your teeth at 3 o'clock. Take a shower at 5 o'clock. And then expect to go out and get anything done. The day's gone. Same thing spiritually. Don't not pray, not read, not witness, not fast, not seek the face of God, not worship, not praise, and then expect to come in church and get breakthrough. Because see, you've lost the whole day spiritually. That's what's happening. The reason people don't have a praise when they come in the church is because they don't have a praise lifestyle at home. They got a fighting at lifestyle. They got a cussing lifestyle. They got a drinking lifestyle. They got all type of things, sports, activities. We got all these lifestyles. But listen, priorities in your life are going to show up, and you can't hide them. Because if you make it priority, I'm going to know it's your priority. If you coming to church is priority, you know how I'm going to know it's priority? Because you're going to be here. If you paying your tithes and your offerings is priority, you know how I'm going to know it's priority in your life? Because all I got to do is look at your checkbook. See, if going to football games and basketball games and baseball games, and we all do it, is priority, you're going to be there before you're here. But see, according to Scripture, that's out of line. Like it, love it, hate it, I don't care. That's what Scripture says. And we are to put kingdom principles first. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness and all these other things, basketball, football, baseball, you name it, it falls under all. All these other things shall be added unto you. Somebody say discipline. So key number two, you must be disciplined. If you're going to be disciplined in the natural, more so in the spirit, you've got to, David, the Bible says he got up early, so you got to get up. You got to get up and you got to pray. You got to get up, you got to study. You got to get up and read. You got to get up and go to church. Listen, and don't be late. Y'all breathing out there? I'm trying to help you. If the president was coming to your house, well, maybe not the president. If a real important person was coming to your house, that's what I'm going to say. I just teased it. Let that go. Delete that off the video. Someone you really liked was coming to your house. And they had priority. Y'all got to quit. If someone with real hierarchy and authority was coming to your house, what would you do? You'd get up early. You'd clean the house. You'd sweep. You'd wash the clothes, clean the sheets. I hope you would. You would go above and beyond. Why? Because you want them to have the best experience that they can have while they're in your presence. Church, we must have that same tenacity when it comes to the presence of God. When he shows up, we ought to have such a tenacious attitude about being cleaned up and washed up and tidying this up and cleansing and purifying and praying and studying and bringing lost ones. When we come into his house, and his presence shows up because the Bible says that he inhabits the praises of his people. When we get him to show up, we need to know that when he gets here, he's going to like what he sees. He's going to have a good experience. He's going to feel welcome. I love the song Brother James taught us today. Holy Spirit, you're welcome in this place. But I look out in the crowd and I see people with their hands down and their faces with a frown on, with their hands in their pockets just looking at us. You know what that tells me? That tells me you ain't been disciplined. You say, I feel like you're judging me. I ain't judging you. Truth sets you free. And if you ain't been disciplined, you decide if you've been disciplined. I want to see this church progress. I want to see this church explode. I want to see souls saved, delivered, set free. Your heart ought to be about the kingdom. More so than about you, it ought to be about the kingdom. And if the kingdom ain't expanding because of what you're doing, then you're not doing what you've been called to do. It's a personal responsibility. Say, everybody say, it's my job. And when we take on that responsibility, not your wife's discipline, not your husband's discipline. I'm talking about your discipline. And if we stay disciplined, we'll have a key, one of the keys that we need to be a giant killer. Somebody say, I'm a giant killer. Number three, giant killers get up. Giant killers get up. The Bible says in verse 20, and David rose early in the morning and left the sheep with the keeper, and he took and went as Jesse had commanded him, and he came to the trench. Now listen, a trench is a ditch, last time I checked. A trench, it could have been 5 feet, could have been 6 feet deep, I don't know, but he was in this trench. He was in a ditch. It's where he was getting his rocks. And we know the giant was 9 foot. So I can only imagine as David is in the trench, he sees the giant. Now the giant don't look just 9 feet. He looks 15, 16 feet. Because when you're in a low place, things that are bigger than you always look bigger than they really are. But a real giant killer, eventually, after you've been in a low place and you've been knocked down and you've messed up and you've made mistakes, maybe you haven't been praying, you haven't been studying, but you get revived, you get hungry for the Lord, you get back in His presence because you know that you ain't right. When you're in that low place, a true giant killer will get up, dust themselves off, and say, you know what, I've been here long enough. I've made mistakes, I've messed up, but I ain't gonna stay here. And that giant, he's really big right now, but listen to me. The God in you is far greater, far bigger than the giant in him. And if you'll get up, God'll get up, God'll show up, God'll fight your battles, but you gotta get up. Don't throw in the towel. Don't allow your mess ups to keep you in the trenches and in the ditches and in the low places. We all go through low places. We've all encountered troubles and trials. But listen, troubles and trials don't come to stay. They're going to come and they're going to pass. The scriptures teach, and it came to pass. It didn't come to stay. It didn't come to camp out with you unless you, take it as a lifestyle. You stay in the trench of depression. You stay in the trench of defeat. It's your choice. But if you're going to be a giant killer, you've got to get up. Somebody say, get up. The enemy looks bigger because you're down or you're in a low place. But God is calling you to higher ground. You'll find out as you get up, God is bigger. Verse 20, it also says that the latter part of verse 20, it says, and he came, he being David, to the trench as the host was going forth to fight and shouted for the battle. Look out. I won't mess some of you up. Because if you're going to be a giant killer, the fourth key to be a giant killer is you must be a shouter. You must be a shouter. Nudge that person that's falling asleep and say, shout! I just woke you up, didn't I? Giant killers ain't afraid to shout. I'm not talking about shouting at your husband or shouting at your wife. I'm talking about getting loud for Jesus. I'm talking about living loud for Jesus, not being ashamed of the gospel. Paul said, I am not ashamed of the gospel, which is in Christ Jesus. Why did he have to say that? He was shouting it. He was declaring it. He was saying, hey, the atmosphere that I'm in needs to know that they can't shut me up. They can't keep me quiet. God's been too good to me. He's been too faithful. He's brought me too far. I'm a shouter, and you can tie my hands. You can throw me on the ground and tie my feet up, but I'm still going to open up
my mouth if you don't take me up. And if you take me up, I'm going to shout it in my head. You can look at me funny. You can frown at me while I sing and while I praise. But I ain't trying to impress you. I'm trying to get a breakthrough. I need God to show up and fight for my family, fight for my children. My God, I'm a giant killer. And sometimes I've got to lift up my voice and shout. Somebody give him a shout of praise today. The Bible says, if you're going to have victory, scriptures teach us, when you lose your shout, your life begins to be bred to breed intimidation. When you quit shouting, when you quit having a voice, there's a scripture. Isaiah chapter 58, verse 1. Write it down. You can look at it in a minute. Isaiah chapter 58, verse 1, it says, cry aloud, spare not. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. Psalm said it like this, shout unto the Lord with the voice of triumph. Clap your hands, all your people. What is he saying? He's saying, if you want your situation to change, if you want your circumstance to change, you must change your atmosphere. Don't shout at the present circumstance, but open up your mouth and give God praise, knowing that when this is over, God's gonna give me victory. Somebody give him praise in this house. Listen, in the book of Joshua, the walls never came down. Read it. It's in there. The walls never came down until somebody blew a trumpet and men and women opened up their mouth and began to shout to God with a shout of praise. We go to football games and basketball games and Ranger games and you look at the signs and it's going to say louder, louder, louder. But we come to church and we got people on the front row, people on the back row, people on the middle row saying quieter, quieter, quieter. I got news for you. That's not the God I serve. I serve a God that's a praising God, a shouting God, a loud God. Somebody said, but it hurts my ears. Come down and get prayed for. It's okay, because the presence of God, he looks for people to worship him in spirit and in truth. My God, my praise is truthful. My worship is in spirit, and I can't help but give God a shout of praise, knowing not only where I've been, but where he's taken me to. And sometimes there's walls that I'm facing that'll never come down until I lift up my voice like a trumpet. Somebody give him a shout of praise in this house. Woo! Giant killers are shouters, not cussers. Shouters. You're going to let the devil, the enemy, shout at you, and you ain't going to shout back? The enemy uses, you know, that's exactly what Goliath was using. He was using the tactic of intimidation, putting on his armor, which took over an hour and a half every time he put it on because it was so heavy, and it took two people to get him coated up. And then he would go out there every day for 40 days, if I'm not mistaken. And he was taunting the children of Israel. And he wasn't going out there, getting in his position and saying, hello, guys. Anyone who wants to come out and fight, let's fight. No, he was cussing. He was a screaming. He was intimidating. He was bashing their faith, bashing their God. He was tearing them down, just like the homosexual movement, just like the court systems, just like people on your job, just like people in churches. They want to shut you up. They don't want you to make them feel uncomfortable. Or they don't want you to do something that they ain't doing, because if you do it, then they're going to feel like they have to do it. Keep doing it. Maybe it'll spread. Enough bad is spread. Maybe if we do enough good, if we do enough worship, if we do enough praise, enough prayer, enough study, enough witness, maybe it'll spread. Church, giant killers scream. They shout. You take me right. I'm not saying scream, shout, and holler at your husband or wife. I'm saying you shout, you give God glory, you give him honor. And instead of being intimidated, you intimidate yourself. You understand that you're a giant killer. You might be small in stature like David, but David didn't fight that battle on his own. He said, I come to you in the name of the Lord. You come to me with a spear and a sword. And I looked at that study, that story in the, again earlier this week, and I've known it, but I forgot it. How many know sometimes you need to look again? Did you know that Goliath, he wasn't out there on that battlefield by himself. He had somebody standing in front of him. It was called a shield bearer. Even the devil has to bring other devils with them because they're afraid of true blood-bought Christians. And you don't need anybody but one drop of the blood. And Jesus said, greater power have I given to you and you and you. If you'll take the authority that I've given you, you can do the impossible. Somebody say, I'm a giant killer. I got three more points. I'm going to shut up and hurry up. Here we go. Number five, verse 25, it says, oh, David asked three times in verse 25, chapter 17, he said, what do I get for defeating this giant? If you're going to be a giant killer, you must understand it's okay to be focused on a reward. David wasn't afraid of asking, what do I get in return? Listen to me. There is a reward. David asked three times, what am I going to get? He wanted to know if his sacrifice was going to pay off. I'm telling you today, there is a reward coming to each and every person who stands up against the enemy, who overcomes sin, who don't quit and throw in the towel, one who decides to be a giant killer and walks the life called a Christian. There is a reward. This Bible calls it a reward of streets of gold, walls of jasper, gates of pearl. There'll be no mourning. There'll be no sorrow. There'll be no tears. There'll be no crying. There'll be no dying. There'll be no cancer. There'll be no Alzheimer's. There'll be no high blood pressure. My God, there'll be no sadness. There'll be no depression. There'll be no disease. What are you talking about? I'm talking about my reward. It's called heaven. We the hell has tried to get us to forget about our reward. Our reward, as we live life and we fight giants, our reward is coming, because to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. How many is looking forward to getting out of here and heading to your reward in heaven tonight? There's a reward. You don't have to forget that there's a reward. There's a reward for praying. There's a reward for seeking the Lord. There's a reward for resisting the devil. There's a reward for not partying and sleeping around. There's a reward for being committed and faithful to the call on your life. Don't forget about heaven. Somebody said, well, I'll serve Jesus if heaven wasn't even real. That can't happen, because heaven is real. It's real. It's as real as you are today. And if you keep living your life and you keep walking faith by faith by faith by faith, you keep putting one foot in front of the other, I got news for you. You're going to get a reward. And when you open up your eyes, you take your last breath here, it'll be your first breath there. And you'll say, my God, it was worth it just to be in the presence of Jesus. Woo! Amen. I can't help but think about a reward. My Lord, Ashley, all of you knew Ashley. She got a reward. She took her last breath, and buddy, she got her reward instantly. We didn't have to cry for her. We didn't have to get sad for her. Some of you got moms and dads. You've lost them. They're gone. And you thought, man, we just lost the battle. Wrong. They won the war. They got their reward. They've been promoted. They've graduated. My Lord, I'm ready for a graduation. How many is ready for a reward tonight? We've been fighting devils. We've been fighting giants. Don't quit. Don't stop thinking. Don't stop recognizing. There's a reward for living holy. There's a reward for doing what's right. There's a reward for studying this Bible. There's a reward for praying. You say, but I don't feel like I'm getting anything out of it. Seek the Lord and he will be found. Knock. How many times I got to knock? Keep knocking. Be persistent. Be disciplined. Don't waver. Don't be confused. Don't give up. Get up. Be faithful. There's a reward. The songwriter said, it will be worth it all when we see Jesus. See, Jesus is the reward. And to be in his presence changes everything. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 24 and 25 says, "Know you not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize? So run that you may obtain. And every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible crown." What is he saying? He said there's a reward for you if you finish this race called life. Matthew 16 and 27 says, "For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels. And when he shall reward every man according to his works, verily I say unto you, there be some standing here which shall not taste of death till they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." Point is, he said, there's a reward that's going to come to the saints. When Jesus splits the eastern sky, he's going to reward each and every one of us, taking us home to glory. Amen? Sixth, giant killers are determined. Somebody say determined. If you're going to be a giant killer, you got to learn how to take a licking and keep on a ticking. When David went down to the stream and he picked up stones, he didn't pick up one stone. He picked up five stones. Some say he picked up five because Goliath was going to be taken out with one, and he had four other brothers, and his plan was to go on a hunting spree. I don't know. But I like to think that the reason David grabbed five stones is because just in case he missed, he had four more. The thing about a true giant killer is that you might miss. You might mess up, but you're determined. You've made up your mind, I ain't going to quit shooting. Stick your hand back in the bag, grab another rock, and keep throwing. You may mess up. You may make a mistake. You may stop coming to church for a while. You may quit praying. My Lord, repent. Fall back on your knees. Get back in the presence of the Lord. Pick up another stone and say, "God, for you I'll live and for you I'll die. I'm going to walk this life because I'm determined to see you face to face. I'm determined to be a giant killer." I got one more scripture for you. In verse 51, the Bible says, after David knocked down the giant, he runs over to Goliath, puts his foot on his chest, pulls out the sword of Goliath, pulls it out of the sheath, which tells me David attacked him so quick, the giant didn't have time to pull his sword out. See, when you are equipped and when you are a giant killer, you know how to attack the enemy better than the enemy knows how to attack you. If you're going to walk in the authority, walk in discipline, walk in determination, if you're going to be a man or woman that knows that there's a reward as a result of for your sacrifice, you also need to understand that giant killers have authority over the enemy. David knew that his authority, it might have been stolen. People, his brother, Eliab, thank you. Eliab was running his mouth. His own brother, his own flesh and blood. "What are you doing here? How come you ain't watching the sheep? You ain't supposed to be out here on the battlefield. This is a man's job, not a boy's job." You ever felt intimidated? How many has ever felt like people looked down on you because you didn't quite add up to what they added up to? They had more, time on the job than you. I got news for you. When it comes to giant killers, I don't care if you just got saved this morning. Alicia, where'd she go? She go to the restroom? I don't care if you just gave your heart to the Lord. I don't care if you just now made a decision to follow Christ. If you'll take the authority, what did he take? How did he get his authority back? The Bible says when he went to Goliath, he takes his sword and he cuts his head off. In scripture, the head always represents authority. What was he saying? He's saying, "We're going to take the authority back. We're going to take back the authority, and I don't want it just for me. I want it for my home." Because the Bible says he takes that old gushy, slimy, dripping head after he cuts it off. It wasn't pretty. Some of you want a pretty service. It ain't pretty when you're a giant killer. Sometimes you got to snot. You got to tear, and you got to cry, and you got to do whatever it takes. And your makeup may start running, your hair may get messed up, you might get wrinkled up, but honey, you got to take some authority back. You got to go in your prayer closet. You got to get in that war room like that movie, and you got to fight for your right to have authority back from the enemy. The Bible says that David took that head, which represented authority, put it on a pole, and stuck it in his house. I think he looked over Brother Eliab and said, Eliab, we ain't had authority in our household in a long time. But I want you to know, every time you look at this old dirty, corn-fed, big-headed monkey, every time you look at him, I want you to know, remind yourself, we took authority back. Took it back in our home. Took it back on the job. Took it back in our church. You got to take authority back. Quit letting the devil run over you. Quit letting the enemy tell you you're defeated. Quit letting the enemy tell you that you're not worth it. No, you got authority. And your authority comes through the name that's above every name. That every demon in hell trembles. And at that name, every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. If you believe that, give him one more hand clap of praise tonight. Amen. Stand to your feet all across this building. Giant killers have authority over the enemy. Keep authority. Quit allowing the enemy to run rapid over you. Quit letting the devil tell you you're not worth it. Take back authority over the enemy. Speak God's word over your circumstances. Remind him, greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. I'm going to do something silly. I want all of you to imaginely reach out, pick up the head of that giant. Come on, grab him by the hair. Come on. Yeah, dripping and all. Raise it up. Look at it. I mean, it's oozing, it's goozing. For some of you, I don't know what your giant is. But he shows his head up. You got to start swinging. Take that sword and just start a cutting. Get it out of your life. And when you cut it off, you may do it at home. You may do it on the job tomorrow. I don't want to hear nobody attacked anybody with a sword on the job now. That's not what I'm saying. But however you behead your giant in the spirit, no ISIS going on here, you pick up... You're holding that head right now. This is what you're saying. You're saying, I'm taking it back. And I'm not just taking it back for me. I'm taking it back for my family. Taking it back for my children. God's given you the ability to overcome. And just because you've lost something doesn't mean you can't find it. Just because the enemy comes attacking you doesn't mean you have to be defeated. Just because you get mad doesn't mean you got to stay mad. Just because you've been hurt doesn't mean you have to allow hurt to keep hurting you. Pick up that head. Come here, Ethan. Come here, Haley. Come here, Abs. Stand right there. Turn around. This is my family. And the devil would have loved for me to give up my authority. When he took their mom out, he would have loved them to think their life's over. But you see, God had a giant killer on the other side of our trouble. He wanted to raise up these children to make them understand just because there's a Goliath doesn't mean you have to be defeated. And I've seen them weep and cry and pray and seek the face of God. And then I've seen the hand of the Lord bring us the miracle that we needed as a family to be whole again through Abby. And as we day by day by day took the head of the enemy and said, we will not settle for this. We're not going to stop praying. We're not going to stop reading. We're not going to keep fighting. Stop fighting. But we're going to keep pushing. We're going to get up. We're going to be disciplined. Not going to stay in the bed. We're not going to be depressed. We're going to walk in victory. God began to put us together and made our home a family again. What I'm telling you is, I don't care what giant you faced, it ain't big enough. It ain't bigger than your God. We've all faced some giants, and we stand before you telling you that if God be for you, no devil in hell can be against you. You're a giant killer. You're a giant killer. Come on. Hallelujah. Stand right here. This is what I want to do. First of all, if you're being baptized, I want you to go ahead and make your way up the stairs. We got quite a few that tonight. If you're a woman, I want you to go that way up the stairs. We'll have someone meet you. If you're a man, go that way. Take your change of clothes. Ushers will take their position. Don't let me lose you. If you're in this place and you've been facing some giants, that's all I got to say. And maybe you don't have one of the seven keys, which that's not the only keys, but that's what God gave me for this house. Maybe you haven't been disciplined. Maybe you forgot about your reward. Maybe you've forgotten to be determined. Maybe you've lost the authority that God's given you. If you face some giants and you want to get back the ability of being an overcomer, you want some prayer, it's okay to be prayed for. I'm fixing to ask you if you want to come get prayed for. Not be ashamed, not be afraid. My family, we're going to pray together. We're going to pray for you. My daughter, my son, and my wife. So if you're facing something right now, would you have boldness like David and say, is there not a cause? Step out of that aisle right now. If you've got a giant in your life, you're facing something, just come line up right across this front. We're not going to make it long. We're just going to lay hands and we're going to agree with you right now. Look at there. There's one, two, three, four. Come on, don't be afraid. I don't care how long you've been coming to church. All of us face giants. Come on, guys. I want you to start laying hands on people and you start praying. Father, in the name of Jesus, pray for them, Haley. Lord, we pray for every need in this house. Lord, every devil, every demonic spirit, every giant that we've encountered, every mom, every grandfather, grandmother that is encountering circumstances and struggles and heartaches, we pull down every stronghold right now. Devil, you're defeated. You're defeated. God is exalted. We speak peace. We speak healing. God, right now, restoration over this family.
You came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life so I can be free. I can be whole. I can tell everyone I know. I will worship
forever.
I'll give you praise. So I can be free. I can be whole. I can tell everyone I know. You thought I was worth saving.
So you came and changed my life.
You thought I was worth keeping. So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life so I can be free. And I can be whole. I can tell everyone I know. You thought I was worth saving. So you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life so I could be free. I can be whole. I can tell everyone I know. And I will praise you.
Forever.
I will give you praise.
Forever.
I'll give you praise.
Forever.
Because I am free.
And now I am whole.
And I will tell everyone I know. You thought I was worth saving. So you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life so I can be free,
and I can
be whole,
and
I can tell everyone I know. So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. So you
sacrificed your life. I could be.
To be baptized upon the confession of her faith. And so raise your hand toward her. She's 10. She needs all of your prayers. Alize, upon the confession of your faith that Jesus Christ lives in your heart. He's your Lord and Savior. We baptize you tonight in the name of the Father, the Son, Jesus, and the Holy Ghost. Woo!
You thought I was worth saving. You came to change my life. You thought I was worth keeping. So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life so I could be free,
and I could be whole,
and I can tell everyone I know.
Church, this is Julian. And he's 10 years old, and of course his father's about to be baptized, one. But upon confession of his faith tonight, Julian, we baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, Jesus, and the Holy Ghost.
You thought I was worth saving, oh my, so you came and changed
my life.
So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was the devil. So you sacrificed your life.
Church. I want you to know that the God we serve is the God for everybody. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Many of you know Juan. He's been around the church. His wife is here. His son was just baptized. But you must know that this man of God has been saved. He's had some troubles in his life, but he's also been addicted to heroin. But he's standing here tonight, free from the power of Satan. Can you give God praise? You know, when he was coming down the steps to be baptized, big old smile on his face, which says it all. Because he knows there's no other life without Christ. And he's the guy you need to be praying for when you're in your prayer time. And others in this house of God. Because we don't want to see anyone not be able to stand. And I know he's going to stand. Raise your hand toward him, because tonight, one upon confession of your faith, that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior. I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, Jesus, and the Holy Ghost.
For it reaches to the highest mountain,
and it flows to the lowest valley.
It's the blood that gives me strength.
Name was. But many of you know John, his family. I tell you, there's just a great bunch of people. And
hallelujah.
He's always in the position of an usher, and he's watching over little lambs. He's doing everything from locking the church up with the other ushers to being here early. It seems like his whole heart is to be a servant. Mm-hmm. And he blesses my heart. I tell him all the time. And this guy he's always thinking outside the box. He's always just forethinking, well, what about this? What about that? And that is a blessing that God has sent him to this house, his family. And tonight, I just want you to know, upon confession, John, of your faith, raise your hand toward him, church. Here's your time. We're going to baptize you tonight in the name of the Father.
Hallelujah.
The Son, Jesus, and the Holy Ghost.
Reaches to the highest mountain,
and it flows
to the lowest valley.
It's the blood
that gives me strength.
Tell you was awesome message tonight Brother Daron preached, and there was a young lady that, to my knowledge, gave her heart to the Lord this morning, Alicia, and she had to get back to the home that they have her in. It's probably on Washington Street or somewhere there at 8 o'clock, so she had to leave about 20 till 8 if you saw her leave out. But she was so excited about coming down this morning, getting saved. And she said, I used to be a meth user. And to my knowledge, probably went to jail over it. But now she's in a home and she's fighting the fight of faith. And she kept telling us after prayer this morning, she says, I got a good heart. And she said, I've got children that they're telling me that I can get back. And we kept encouraging her. And she couldn't wait to be baptized tonight. So I don't know, we might have to fill this thing up and dunk her next Sunday morning. Because we're not going to let her get away. As everyone is standing right now in the house, we're just going to pray a prayer and believe that God's going to keep us, watch over us. I want to say from the bottom of my heart, I'm thankful that you came tonight. I appreciate your faithfulness. Appreciate Brother Daron bringing that word to let us know that we are giant killers. Don't you let anything or anyone discourage you. The church is not going under. The church is going over. Grab your neighbor by the hand. United we stand.